Greetings, salutations, and welcome back to GameSpot Cross Kinda Funny. My name is Colin Moriarty. I'm joined here by my favorite game developer of all time, Keiji Inafune, as well as Nick Yu, and we're going to talk about Mighty No. 9, as well as some other pretty cool stuff, which I'm excited about. But we're going to focus on Mighty No. 9 because I'm a huge dork with Mega Man, and this is its spiritual successor. So guys, thank you for joining me so much.
Thank you.
I appreciate it. So we're close. We're real close now to getting Mighty.
Yes, we are.
How are you guys feeling about it?
もうマイティの発売がだいぶ近くになってきますけど、どんな心境でいらっしゃいますか？
そうですね、楽しみですね。やっぱりユーザーに届けられるってここまで持ってこれたっていうことと、ユーザーに楽しんでもらえる顔が目に浮かぶんで、すごく楽しみです。
So we're getting real close, and it's been almost 2 years now, and you know, the development has been going really smoothly, and we can, you know, almost feel like we can finally deliver this to the users, to the players. So we're super, super excited.
I am too. How has it been working outside of the publisher structure? I mean, obviously you're working with your partners with Deep Silver and stuff like that, but you kickstarted the game and kind of developed it on your own using crowdfunding. So how has that been, and how has that been different?
まあ、今回の、プロジェクトって、キックスターター、まあ、っていうこともあって、そのパブリッシャーっていうふうな、ところとは一緒に仕事をしてないっていうふうに思うんですけど、その、まあ、パブリッシャーと仕事するのとの違いとかってあったりしますか？
そうですね、やっぱり、まあ、言ってしまえば自由はありますよね。自分たちが考えて自分たちがやりたいようにやれるっていうのがパブリッシャーがいない状況なんで、パブリッシャーがついちゃうとそこに対して、まあ、パブリッシャーの意見っていうのを当然聞いていかなきゃいけないんで、やっぱりちょっと意見が分かれた時にはやっぱりちょっと困ることっていうのがあるんで、そういう意味ではずっと自由にやってこれて、で今ディープシルバーといい関係でやれてるんで、そこはさらにその自由にやらせてもらってます。
So simply put, lots of more freedom to the development of the game, and we're not saying that working with the publisher is a bad thing, but it's just sometimesfrom their standpoint, they want to get the game to be like this, but we actually want to do the game like this. So there are split opinions happening. So when that happens, that we kind of have to take an extra step, you know, have a meeting and talk about like what to do about this situation. But since we didn't have any publisher this time, we are just, you know, doing whatever we want to make and making that game happening. But now we're teaming up with Deep Silver, and they are really, you know, respecting our creative freedom. So they're actually letting us do whatever we want to do and continuing that. So they're just supporting our development of the game.
What's the reaction been to, obviously you guys released kind of an early beta or kind of a sampling of this of the game, which I enjoyed very much, and it's basically one stage. You kind of learn the mechanics of the game, kind of the comboing and the point system. What's the reaction been to what you guys have shown, and are you optimistic that people are going to receive it well?
まあ、今回のゲームって、まあ、ベータとかあったんですけれども、結構その開発をこうバッカに対してずっとフィードバック見せていたっていう感じなんですけども、そのまあ特にベータを見せた時のその反応とかって、まあちょっと心配してましたか？そのどういう反応が起きるかっていうのが。
そうですね、やっぱり最初は、どういうネガティブな反応があるのかなっていうことを考えて思ってたんですけど、かなりポジティブな反応の方が多くて、当然その自分たちが、開発者、いろんな開発者に触ってもらうということでもすごくポジティブな反応多かったですし、ベータサービスでユーザーに触ってもらうとかっていうのもすごい反応が良かったですね。この間インディーズフェスタっていうところで日本でこれも一般ユーザーに触ってもらったんですけど、すごい反応が良くって、怖いぐらいのポジティブな反応があったっていうのは、すごく嬉しいですね。
So we were, before we showed the beta access to the backers, we were kind of worried that there might be some negative comments about the game, how it turned out, because that's the first time they are actually playing the game and seeing the game in action. And until then, it's only about, concept art or, the setting that we want to make and we're showing to them. So that was the first time we were showing the gameplay or anything like that. So we were kind of worried, but from the beta testing, all the comments are mostly positive. And just a couple of weeks back, we had this event called Tokyo Indie Game Fest. There, some of the Japanese players have first time to has a chance to play the game, and their feedbacks are as also overwhelmingly positive. So that's kind of a big relief for us. So not just the Western audience, but also the Japanese audience seems to like what we're doing right now.
Awesome. And how's it been kind of working with, for you, with IniCreates, obviously they did Mega Man 9 and Mega Man 10, and they have that old school pedigree with, you know, Gunvolt and all these kinds of games. But how has it been kind of working with a different team, a new team, to get this game out, or at least work on the game to get it out, I guess, later this summer? Has it been a
actually experience? We are working with, you know, the same team from
Mega Man 9, yes, and Mega Man 10. So it's the same, the same whole
the structure. I mean, the specific, like, detailed team members might be a little bit different.
Oh, okay.
But it's the same company.
Oh, that's all. Well, yeah, I thought maybe different teams. That's awesome to know.
Right.
So my confidence is now through the roof, because 9 and 10 were so true. So it's been a good experience then.
インティさんとは多分前にも仕事してると思ってしてたことあると思うんですけども、そのまあメガ、6万9とか10作ってた時にあったと思うんですけども、まあ、今回も一緒にやっていて何か変わったこととかっていうのはそのあったりするんでしょうか。
そうですね、あのインティ自体は本当に信頼できるディベロッパーで、あの本当に自分たちでも考えて作ってくるし、やっぱりあのこっちの意見をしっかりと聞くっていうことがあるんで、 ある意味あの僕自身を本当にリスペクトしてくれてる、ディベロッパーじゃないかな。だから、こうしたいってことを伝えた時に、それ以上のことでやっぱ返ってくるっていうディベロッパーなんで、本当にいいゲームを作るにはやっぱインティグレーツのような会社とやれるっていうのはすごく、やりがいがありますね。
So I personally I very very much trust Indie Creates、when it comes to making this kind of game, because they have been making this kind of 2D side score game all their lives.And their experience, they know what to do. And because there's that trust between us, sometimes when I send them the feedback, they will actually bring back to me something new or on top of that feedback, because they kind of know that, you know what, I think this is what Inafune-san is thinking. So based on that, if we add this idea into it, we should make it something better.And so when that happens, you know, that's what we call the good chemistry happens. When that happens, I'm really glad that I choose Indie to create this game, because they really know what they're doing.
How have the people that have seen the game and the fans, the old school Mega Man fans that are certainly excited about this, how have they reacted to the 2.5D sort of look of the game as opposed to the more 8-bit style?
まあ、今回、結構そのまあクラシックな日本 の, そのサイドスクロールゲームのファンって、まあ 2.5D っていうのに対してちょっとまあ拒絶反応を持つっていうか、そういうのがあるかと思うんですけども、今回の場合っていうふうには何か それに関するそのフィードバックってありましたか。
最初キックスタート始めた時に割とそのいうネガティブな反応っていうのは多少あったんですけど、実際ゲーム進めていって触ってもらうところとかベータサービスとかのところで、その 2.5D に対してのなんていうか嫌悪感、ネガティブな反応というのはほとんど聞かれなくなったかなと思って、もちろんないわけじゃないけど、あまりそこを気にする必要なくなったなというのが印象ですね。
So when we starting off our Kickstarter campaign, there are some people, you know, confused or saying, you know, almost a negative thing about 2.5D. And as soon as we starting to show the gameplay or the beta, people are kind of seeWhy we chose the 2.5D. So the more we show, the less they become, you know, the comments are become less and less about they don't like 2.5D or they don't think this is a good idea. So I think we're going in a good direction with this.
And how, you know, a couple of the other times that we've met, I often ask you about Mega Man. And now I want to ask you more about Beck and Mighty in terms of, have you found...the soul of this character? I remember you drawing Mega Man for me once, and it just came out so naturally. It's like you weren't even thinking about it. Do you feel that way now about Beck? And is this a character that you've really found the soul and the essence of?
まあ、以前そのちょっとレートしてあげますけども、以前その稲船さんにその六万のこう絵を描いてもらった時があるんですけども、すごいこうなんか本当に稲船さんはそのロックマンの魂をこう自分の中に持っていて、もう自然に出てくるような感じで描いてもらってたんですけども、まあ、今回の新しいこのキャラクターベックっていうキャラクターに対して稲船さん的にはそのもうこう魂を持ってこれるキャラクターになってるんでしょうかっていう質問です。
そうですね、当然僕自身もメガマン大好きですし、やっぱりこう描くって未だにこう描くのはスムーズに描けるんですね。でもベック自体をどんどんどんどん好きになってる自分っていうのがいて、でこの間リワード用に400ぐらいすごく高額のリワードしてくれた方に向けてスケッチをずっと毎日毎日描いてたんだけど、だんだんとメガマンと同じようなぐらい魂込めて描けるようになってきたんで、 本当にベック自体も僕自身の魂をしっかり入れれる形になりましたね。
You know, this is kind of an interesting case because we are starting a new IP. We're making a new character. We're actually starting from the scratch. So as the development of the game go on, we see more and more about Beck, who is Beck and what he will do, what kind of character he is. So in that sense, I'm definitely seeing more soul in this character in myself, within myself. And the funny thing, you should bring up the time when he draw the Mega Man sketch for you, because just until like a couple weeks ago, we just finished 400 sketches of Beck's face and the signature. So this was actually one of the reward we posted out during our Kickstarter campaign. So by the time I finished the 400 ones, I really feel I can draw him smoothly and almost reacting. There's not thinking or thinking about drawing anymore. That's just gonna kind of all the flow to it. So I think there is a Beck inside of me now, and he has a soul of his own.
One of the things that surprised me when I played the beta, and this was a long time ago when you guys released it, was that people, you know, this is a spiritual successor to Mega Man, or at least something that's heavily inspired by Mega Man, but as a huge Mega Man fan and a classic, you know, 8-bit Mega Man fan, I see that this game is not like Mega Man in many ways, and I'm wondering, you know, it seems fast, it's point-driven, it's combo-driven, a lot of these kinds of things. Is it fair to say that the game is both inspired by Mega Man, but also quite different?
まあ、自分はすごいロックマン大ファンなんですけども、結構ベータとかだいぶ前からもプレイしていて、まあ、プレイしてて思ったのが、まあ、このゲームってロックマン その後継者というふうに言われてますけど、なんかちょっとやっぱ違うなっていうふうなこう、うん、感覚になったんですね。まあ、そこで聞きたいのが、その稲船さん的にはもうこのゲームって、まあ、メガロックマンをこう意識で作ったゲームなのか、それともこうなんていうんですかね、また別のものを意識して作ったゲームなのかっていう、そのロックマンとの関係とかっていうのはどうなんでしょうか。
そうやね、やっぱこのゲーム、そのメガマンチックな部分あると思うんだけど、やっぱメガマンのコピーしたいと思って作ったわけじゃないんで、やっぱり自分自身の中にあるそのメガマンのような横スクロールアクションの完成形みたいなところを目指して作ったところがあるんで、だからなんていうのかな、やっぱりそのメガマンのようでメガマンじゃないっていう意見が割とすごく強くみんなから言われるんだけど、狙った通りなんだよね。メガマンのようだけどメガマンじゃないその面白さみたいな、しかもそれがネガティブなメガマンじゃないじゃなくてポジティブなメガマンじゃないって進化をちゃんと認めてくれたその言い方になってるんで、それはすごい狙った通りなんで、それ自身をやっぱり作りたかったっていうのが俺のその本音だよね。
So when we first started making this game, we didn't really have, you know, the Mega Man. We want to make a Mega Man game, or we're, you know, want to make this game based on Mega Man or anything like that. What he had was, I want to make a 2D side-scroll game, but I want to make it new. So that's where the whole idea started. And the feedback, like you said, it feels kind of Mega Man, but it's really not. That's the kind of thing I kind of aim for, because back in the days, all the older retro 2D side-scroll games has, you know, slower gameplay.
Right.
You kind of want to be safe, you keep your distance with the enemy, and you don't want to die. But that kind of gameplay style, where the tempo, I think is out of the date right now. So I want something new and something fast and speedy. So that's where we kind of aim for. And with this game, with the new absorption dash, I think we totally achieved that goal. So your feedback saying it looks like a Mega Man, it kind of feels like it, but it's not, is exactly what we aim for.
Perfect. One of the things that Mega Man fans seem to relate to most with those games are the bosses, the Robot Masters. And one of the things I love so much about the new trailer was that we got to see the bosses at least kind of fly by the screen. You know, do you anticipate or do you hope that people associate with some of these bosses like I did as a kid with Magnet Man or Quick Man or Bomb Man or whatever, when I really loved these characters? Do you hope that that you kind of capture that same essence with these particular enemies?
またちょっとロクマンの話ですけども、そのロクマンってこうボスがいろんな種類のボスがいて、まあ、その、ボスを倒して、まあ、パワーを得てっていう風にこうボスの魅力っていうのもなんかあったと思うんですね。で今回ももちろんそのトレーラーとか見たらそのいろんなボスがいて、結構個性的なボスがいろんないるんですけども、 同じようにそのボスの個性もちょっと出していくような、感じの作りにしたかったんでしょうか。
そうね、メガマンよりも、ボスの個性出したいっていうふうに思ったんね。要は、メガマンの時っていうのはボス自体は倒すべき相手、要は憎らしい相手っていう形なんだけど、うん、今回の、マイティナンバーナインっていうのは憎らしくなくて助けるべき相手っていう形 で助けたことによって得られるものっていう、で助けることによって正常に戻って仲間になって助けてくれる、さらに助けてくれるっていう、うん、だからそういう部分があるんで、やっぱり個性っていうのをより大事にしないと使い捨てじゃないっていうところがあるんで、だからすごいより性格付けみたいなところ、うん、好きになってもらうっていう、このゲームやってマイティナンバーズを全員好きになってもらうような形のゲームにしたつもりです。
So, you know, comparing with Mega Man, the Robot Masters, those bosses, they're actually your enemies. But in Mighty No. 9's case, they're actually not your enemies, but they're your siblings. What you're trying to do is save them from this computer virus. You're kind of cleansing them from this, you know, bring back them to their sane self. So you're actually saving them. You're not just, you know, killing them or defeating them. And like you said, we wanted to make each of the bosses, you know,give them a unique personality, unique ability, and they can still stand alone by themselves. And I think we really achieved that with this game. So what we're hoping for right now is by the end of the game, you know, everyone, or the players will actually love each of the bosses that you fought, because you actually, depends on which boss you save, they actually come into the stage and help you out time to time. So,That's the kind of relationship we want to try to aim with the, you know, between the players and the bosses.
I'm curious, you know, I know that when you created Mega Man or Rockman in the 80s, you drew and created at least the first six enemies and obviously Mega Man himself, and then you opened it up to, you know, basically kids and adults in Japan to create the rest of them, and then you would draw them in your style. Did you create all these enemies yourself, or did you let some of the guys at IndieCreates do their thing?
まあ、ロックマン作った時って最初のタイトルの時は、まあ、全部自分たちで書いたと思うんですけど、その後にこう結構ファンからデザインを募集したりとかやってたと思うんですね。で、今回のこのマイティナンバーナインの場合って、まあ、募集は多分ないと思うんですけども、その本当に全部自分で稲船さんが自分で書いたんでしょうか、それとも他のデザイナーがいたんでしょうか。
コンセプトにはキャラクターデザインする人間が何人かいるんで、どっちかいうと直接自分自身が書くっていうよりは指示しながら、たまにこうだよって言って書いたそのままになったりする時があるんだけど、一緒に指示しながらやっていくっていう形で、あんまり稲船の個性が出すぎないように今回は考えてやったんだけど、逆にうちのデザイナーが稲船さんらしいデザインにしようっていうことで、こっちに合わせてくれたりとかして、なんかまあいい関係でいろんな新しい形も取り入れられてるかなと思います。
So I guess the simple answer is like half and half, because I didn't actually design them, but I gave them a lot of feedbacks from my perspective. And within concept, we have a couple of designers, really good designers. They are the guys who actually mainly designed the design for the robots. So when they, you know, bring me their design, I'll give them feedback. And sometimes I'll actually do a quick doodle and say, you know, explaining what kind of things I have in mind.But that ended up being just that. And then the next time they bring back the design, it will be exactly the same thing I drew. So it's kind of a weird thing that we did with the designs, because I actually don't want to have too much of my design influence into the designs. But the designers actually wanted my influence into the designs. So it's kind of a weird mixture that's happening right now. So that's why I say, you know, it's kind of half and half.
And...I'm curious, you know, earlier I asked about the publisher structure and kickstarting your game and crowdfunding and all of that. What's the feedback loop in terms of getting feedback, obviously, from the people that are backing you? Obviously, you're reading the comments and you're reading the information they're saying on the beta and stuff. How have you reacted to that? Because that must be a different experience than being in a publisher where you're, maybe they're playtesting, they're maybe paying to have the game examined.By external playtesters, but you're not having direct feedback. So how has that experience been in making this game?
今回、まあ、いつもその普段通りの、 そのパブリッシャーさんとやってる時って、フィードバックってメインがパブリッシャーのフィードバックが返ってきて、で、まあ、 バッカーですね、プレイヤーのフィードバックで結構後の方に来ると思うんですけども、今回の、まあ、キックスターターのプロジェクトって最初からもう、直にそのバッカーとかからファンからフィードバックが来るんですけども、それに対してのな その、まあ、やり方っていうのはそのどういう感じでしたか。なんかこう違ったこととか面白かったこととかあったりするんですか。
本来こうあるべきかなとは思うんですね。やっぱりユーザーなかなかあのゲームって発売の言ったら何ヶ月か前に発表じゃん。E3 で発表しましたって言って、その例えば長くても1年後に発売するとか、ある程度そこまでは作ってるっていう、である程度できたものに対してユーザーのフィードバックがあるっていう。で今回キックスターターにでやったんで、ある程度もクソも何もできてない状態でユーザーのフィードバックを入れていくっていう。本来であればこんな風にしたいんだよっていうざっくり決まってるものからあの意見取り入れていった方が本当にこうユーザーのやりたいものになっていくんじゃないかなっていう。だからそれはあのキックスターターのおかげでやれてるし、あの面倒くさい部分もあるんだけど、どっちかというと自分たちが迷った時にユーザーに聞くっていう姿勢にしてるんで、あのその辺はあのユーザーにあの任せすぎない、要はまだできてないものをどうしたらいいって言ってもなかなか言えないと思うんで、やっぱり迷った時にどっちがいいみたいな形で聞いて、それはうまくいったかなと思って。
So generally speaking, I'm sure this is not the 100% the case, but when you're working with a publisher, when you're saying announcing some game in this year's E3, that means you have already worked on the game for at least a year, maybe half years before that. So whatever you're showing and the first time you're getting the feedback from the users or the players is based on what you're showing to them at that point. But in the Kickstarter case, we actually don't even have anything to show to the backers.Whatever we have at that point, we just show it to everyone. I think, in a sense, that's almost like a natural way to do it, because we are building this game together with the fans, so they have the right to know what's going on and what's happening within the project. So whenever we actually ask the backers to do a survey or a design contest or whatever that's happening, that's actually when we are, you know, within the dev team, that their opinions are totally split into two ways or three ways.Then we're all turning to the backers saying, you know what, we can't decide what's going on, what to do with this one. What do you guys think? I think that relationship that's between the backers and us, the dev team, went really nicely in this case. So that's kind of the main difference between the publisher, doing the publisher way or doing the Kickstarter way.
Has it been interesting, or have you noticed the influence that you've had and this project has had on other Kickstarters?I feel like there was a direct influence with Koji Igarashi, specifically with Bloodstained, which you know, has done extraordinarily well on Kickstarter. Have you seen that, and does that kind of honor you to kind of convince other developers, your peers basically, that they also can go independent, they also can go directly to their fans to get exactly what they want?
Sorry, can you just repeat the first part? I couldn't hear because of the...
Oh, I'm sorry. Basically, the question was, with something like Koji Igarashi's Bloodstained, mm-hmm. Does Mr. Inafune realize or think that he's inspired other developers, you know, especially his peers in Japan, right. that they can find great success too by delivering exactly what maybe primarily Western audiences want, mm-hmm. But otherwise wouldn't get from the publisher structure?
まあ、最近で言うと、五十嵐さんのブラッドステインドは結構大きな成功を収めましたけども、まあ、稲船さん的にはその、まあ、自分のこのマイティナンバー9の成功で、こう他のそのインディペンデントのそのディベロッパーが、まあ、との有名なディベロッパーが、こうキックスターターに踏み出したのっていうふうに思えますかっていう質問です。
そうですね、勇気を与えることができたかなっていう。やっぱりあのキックスターターやることによってチャレンジしてあの自分で道を開くっていうことを、まあ、五十嵐さんも、まあ、あの鈴木優さんも最近ではねそうだと思うけど、あのそういうなんか勇気を与えることができたかな。僕らは、まあ、もっと前にやってるんでスタートじゃなくてもうゴールのとこまで来てるんで、ゴールすることによってさらに勇気与えられるんじゃないかなっていうふうに思ってます。
So, you know, I can't really say this for 100% for sure, but hopefully, my Kickstarter had some kind of impact to them when they're thinking about it. Maybe we should do one Kickstarter, because we actually started this and we proved that it's possible to start an IP or to start a project through Kickstarter. And I think that's one of the things I think we should have encouraged them. And by now, since our game is almost over, we're almost at the finish line, once we finish the game, we can encourage more people saying, you know what, we can actually finish a project through a Kickstarter. So hopefully that's the case. And I wish, you know, Yu Suzuki-san, hopefully a big success in their Kickstarter. I know they're already funded.
Yeah. Oh yeah, they're doing great. One last question before we go to break, for the other side of the interview. How should people primarily be playing Mighty? And I ask this question because the game is point-based and it's fast. Are you anticipating that people are going to play it in a more elegant style? Are they going to play it in a more fast style? Are they going to be speedrunning it? Are they going to be going for high scores? Or is it basically, are you hoping that people play it at their leisure? And I ask that simply because with 8-bit Mega Man games, for instance, you either play them, you know, you play them well, or you play them slow or plodding, or you speedrun them, and that's basically it. But now there's all these kinds of things to measure your progress and how you're playing it. So how do you anticipate people will play it, or how do you want to see them people play it?
このゲームって結構、まあペースが速いゲームですけども、昔のゲームとかに比べると、まあ、ちょっと違ったゲームプレイになっているたりするじゃないですか。結構最終そのゴールした時にこういろんなこう数値が出たりして、その稲船さんの、まあ理想なこのみんなにプレイしてもらいたいスタイルっていうのはどんななんですか。そのスピードランなのか、そのどういう感じでこうプレイヤーにプレイしてほしいですか。
そうですね、今回すごく考えて、多分多種多様だと思ってるんだよね。だから本当にレトロなゲームを楽しみたいって思ってる人もいれば、新しい形のアクションゲーム楽しみたいと思ってる。で、俺自身は新しい形を楽しみないと思ってるんで、やっぱりスピードのあるその吸収ダッシュを中心にどんどん進んでいくっていうのをやりたいと思ってる。でも一つ絶対入れたかったのが、昔のやり方でもある程度進むっていう、だメガマンと同じような戦い方をしてもこのゲーム実は進むように作られてて、別に吸収ダッシュしなきゃいけないわけじゃなくて、どんどんどんどん倒していくっていう形で進んでいくようにもう出来上がってて、やりたいように自分でプレイできるような形を作ったつもりなんで、ぜひそういうところで一回今のゲームって楽しんで、一回レトロに楽しもうかなと思って全部倒していくっていうやり方も遊んでもらえたら面白いんじゃないかなって。
So I think actually we can go, you know, both ways when you play this game. You can either, you know, just shooting the enemies and killing them and then progress, or you can actually stun them and use your absorption dash and finish off them fast andyou know, speed run kind of thing. So the thing I really wanted to do is giving the players the option of choosing the style they want to play. You can play with it, you know, like the old 2D side-scroll game style, or you can play the new style with, you know, speed and good tempo. So I myself, Inafune himself, wants to play, you know, the fast tempo and speedy, you know, gameplay. But I'm pretty sure that there are people out there who want to play the old style.So they have the choice to however they want to play it. But I like the speedy one myself.
Perfect. So we're about to go to commercial, but before we do, I want to, you know, Mighty No. 9 comes out when and what platforms will it be on so people know?
Mighty No. 9, もうすぐコマーシャルなんですけど、Mighty No. 9のその、プラットフォームと、あと発売日教えてください。
そうですね、Mighty No. 9は、Xbox One、PlayStation 3、4、Xbox 360もね、Wii U が9月の15日に全米で発売で、全世界では日本も含めて9月の18日の発売です。
So the shortest version is we have every single console out there. And so to name a few, or to name everything, we have PC for Steam and Mac and Linux, and PS4, PS3,Xbox 360, Xbox One, and Wii U. We're coming out at September 15th for North America and September 18th for around the world. And 3DS and PS Vita version are coming out a little bit later than that.
Perfect. Well, there it is, Mighty No. 9. We're going to come back with 30 more minutes with my favorite developer of all time, Keiji Inafune. We're going to talk about some other things. So I want to talk a little bit about the Japanese gaming industry, his other game, ReCore.And of course other random things like what his favorite game of this show is since we're at E3. So we'll be back right after this. What's up? We're back with KG Inafune as well as Nick Yu, and we're talking about Mighty No. 9 as well as some other cool stuff. But what I want to ask Mr. Inafune now, since he's such a seasoned veteran of the games industry, is something really simple. We're here at E3. We're seeing lots of new games. Did Mr. Inafune get to see any of the press conferences, and what did he think of those?
すごく今回の E3 面白そうなゲームが多いなと思ってて、もう発売前とかももちろんありますけど、やりたいなっていうゲームとか、待ちに待ってたゲームがやっと発売日とか決まりかけてるみたいなのがあったりとかして、本当に何やろ、どれがっていうよりはいいなっていうタイトル多いですね。で、まあ、その中でもリコアっていうね自分のタイトルだけど、
はい、
ね、珍しくブランニューのオリジナルタイトルっていうのを発表できたんで、これもやっぱり E3 の目玉じゃないですかね。
So actually, I've seen a lot of interesting games, some of the games I actually want to play and looking forward to, and some of the games that actually announced their release date, that's getting me really excited. But my personal favorite is this game called ReCore.Which is original IP by me and Armature Studio and Microsoft. So I'm really looking forward to that one and hearing more news about that game.
Yeah, tell me a little bit more about ReCore. And I mean, I know you can't get too into it. I mean, you have publishers in your... How did this even happen? Armature, obviously a studio of Metroid Prime veterans from Retro. How did you guys meet up with them? And then how did you find your way on the Xbox?
まあ、じゃあそのリコアについてちょっとお聞きしたいんですけども、この話ってどっから始まったんですか？どういう関係でアマチュアとつながって、どういう関係でマイクロソフトと一緒にやることになったんですか？
そうですね、アマチュアとは、実はカプコン時代に一緒に仕事してて、すごくいい形で彼らと仕事ができてたんですよね。で、結局僕が辞めちゃったんで、プロジェクト自体は進まなくなっちゃったんですけど、彼らとの仕事をもう一回やりたいっていうことで、彼らと何か考えられないかっていうことをちょうどやってた時に、いいゲームをちょっと思いついて、これでやりたいなっていうので、でそれをパブリッシャーに持ち込んでっていう形で、マイクロソフトに持ち込んだ時にマイクロソフトもすごくいい反応を示してくれて、でじゃあ一緒にやりましょうっていうことで、マイクロソフトのチームも入って、でより中身を詰めていったっていうのが今回ですね。
So Armature StudioI actually have worked with them back in the Capcom days, and the relationship with that studio was really nice, and the game was turning out very nicely. But since I left the company, I think that project got canceled and didn't move forward from there. So it's a bummer. But I always really liked Armature Studio and always thought about working with them again. So when this whole thing came out, I was thinking maybe I want to do something new.And then that's when I thought about Armature Studio, and I started talking with them and see they're interested in working in some kind of new project, and they just said yes. So now we're looking for a new publisher or someone to work with, to work together with this title. And that's when Microsoft came into the picture, and they're not only being a publisher, but they're actually bringing in their own team into the dev team, and it's pretty much like three companies working together on this title.
Speaking of that and kind of finding the teams you want to work with, people certainly must be knocking down your door, right, to work with you. Are you approached all the time by publishers and developers to kind of produce their game, direct their game, creatively direct their game, whatever? You must be approached constantly.
まあ、稲根さんの今いろんなパートナーと一緒にやるっていうふうに話聞いてるんですけども、結構多分稲船さんの方にも一緒にやりたいっていう話がいろいろ来ると思うんですけども、そこら辺ってどうなんですか？
そうですね、そんなに来ないですね多分やりたいと思ってる人たくさんいると思うんですけど、なかなか本当にこうね、ビジネスっていう形で真剣に考えた時にはいろんな障害があったりとかするんで、本当にね、うまくいろんなところとやれるといいなとは思うんですけど、やっぱりこうオリジナルとかそういうものをもっと求めてる時代になったら、僕自身がもっとこう動けるのかなっていうふうに思います。
So not as much as you think. People do tend to come to me about making new ideas or making new games. But from a business standpoint, it's kind of getting really hard to start a new IP or start a new franchise. So there's, you know, less people coming to me saying, you know, let's work something together. There's just too many hurdles right. or too many walls to crash before you can get, you know, green lit or started. So hopefully, you know, the game industry will become more open to new ideas or to new IPs. That's, I think, when people are, you know, will feel more freely approaching to me or approaching to each other starting new IPs.
And, you know, what struck me about ReCore as opposed to Mighty is that Mighty's on everything, like you guys were saying, you were laughing about Mighty's on every platform imaginable. And, you know, ReCore is going to be on Xbox One specifically. That certainly must make it easier, right, when you're overlooking a project or helping to produce a project to focus on one particular platform as opposed to many, and plus you have the resources of a publisher and a big stakeholder, actually, a platform holder. So is that just a totally different experience than what you're used to?
そのマイティなマネに比べて、まあ、マイティはもう全プラットフォームであるんですけども、そのまあ、リコアに関しては本当に1プラットフォームじゃないですか。でこのまあ違いって もちろん多分1プラットフォームをやりやすいと思うんですけども、何か別な違いとかあったりするんでしょうか。
そうですね、本当はあの全てのプラットフォームで、いろんな人があの選ばずに、あのやっぱり全ての人に届けられる形がいいと思ってるんですけど、あのやっぱりそうもいかない部分はあると思いますんで、やっぱりあの技術的にとかいろんな意味で楽なのは一つっていうのが分かると思うんだけど、でもやっぱりたくさんの人たちに楽しんでもらうっていうのをやっぱりゲームクリエイターとしては自分たちのやりたいことなんで、あのそこを求めてはあの今もいますし、できる限りそういうふうな形でやりたいなっていう気持ちはあります。
So it's kind of two sides fighting against each other within myself, because one side, you knowAs a game creator, I want my game to be played by everyone.
Right.
That means all platforms. However, you know, that kind of brings in the hurdles of, you know, porting into different consoles, and just that much, you know, extra work to be done. But on the other hand, doing only one console, we can actually really focus on that thing, and, you know, technical-wise, it's much easier to do just one console. So there's just always the two sides fighting against each other. And also there's a you know, business aspect,or the schedule, or anything like that. So, in a sense, there's one easier way, but that's not the really way that we should be taking. You know, as a game creator myself, I want everyone to be able to play my game.
Oh, interesting. And tell me a little bit more about what's going on at Comcept, because you guys seem to have a lot of balls in the air at any given time. I mean, I remember, you know, Soul Sacrifice, for instance, and all these other games.How many games do you have in development right now, or at least that you have your tendrils on in terms of the games、
right.
you might be producing? How many of those games are in development?
まあ、コンセプトっていう会社は結構いろんなプロジェクトを一緒にこう抱えてる感じがするんですけども、例えば、まあ、前話した時はそのソウルサクリファイスがやってたりとかしてますけども、まあ、現在はマイティもそのリコアもありますけども、まあ、大々にですけど、どんぐらいのゲーム、どんぐらいのプロジェクトを同時に今走らせてる状態なんでしょう？今言える範囲で。
そうですね、僕自身の構想でいうともう山ほどあって、いろんな多分ニックも分かるようにすごい企画書があるよね俺たちは。その中で何個か走ってるっていうのがあって、本当にいろんな意見話をいただけると、その中からいろんな企画を出して一緒に進められる。で自分たちの利点は自分たちだけで完結しているディベロッパーじゃないっていうことが利点だと思ってる。じゃあアマチュアのような会社であったりとか、インディグリエイツのような会社と組んで、言うと自分たちのコンセプトさえあればいろんな会社と力を合わせながら、もちろん限界はあるけど、同時に進められることができるっていう、その利点を生かして、たくさんのね、やっぱりクリエイター人生って言ったらまだずっとずっとあるわけじゃないんで、できる限りこのクリエイター人生限られてる中で自分の考えてるものを全部出したいんで、そういう進み方、そういうゲームの作り方をしてます。
So company wise, we just have too many ideas right now that's happening, and this is from my personal point of view. I actually have a stack of pitch document on my desk just sitting there ready to go, and we actually have a vault of justideas that's in there, or the pitch document in there. You know, we can just bring out and talk with people and see if they're interested. We're the kind of company that's making ideas or making concept. So that's what we're doing right now. So that's why we have so many ideas in the air at this moment. And personally, as a game creator, you know, my career is not, you know, limitless. There's only, you know, so many numbers of games I can do in my gaming career. And within that time, I hope that I can do as many, I can, you know, make realize as many ideas as possible inside my head. And that's what we're aiming for right now.
One of the things I've always admired about you, even though Mega Man's like my favorite thing of all time, is that you've produced or had your hands on a lot of other different games, whether you're at Capcom or now, and you've, you know, it's Animusho or Dead Rising or whatever it might be. You like to make different kinds of games. Soul Sacrifice is one kind of game, Mighty is another kind of game. Are there any kind of games that you haven't been able to make that you want to make? A role-playing game or something, you know, or like a JRPG, something super nerdy like that, or is it, or are you kind of comfortable in these certain spaces?
で、まあ、いろんなジャンルやってきてると思うんですけども、その稲船さんが今までまだやったことないジャンルのゲームで、これからちょっとやってみたいなっていうのが何かありますか？
そうですね、あのやりたいこと全部やってきたところがあって、ゾンビってやりたいなとか、ロボットやりたいなとか、あの魔法使いやりたいなとかっていうのすごくあって、大体やってきたんだけど、まあ、やってないところで言うと、そうですね、あのやっぱりなんていうのかな、あの今回もしかしたら目指せるかもしれないと思ってリコアをやらせてもらってるんだけど、やっぱり小さな子供から大人まで全員が面白いと思えるゲーム作りっていうのをやってみたいんだよね。だから一生の間で1回だけそれで成功したいなっていうのがあって、宮本さんが、宮本茂さんが、あの簡単にこなす一番難しいところをちょっとあの宮本さんに近づきたいなっていう意味合いでやりたいっていうふうには思ってますね。
So all my games until this point, you know, I have done a lot of different genres and a lot of different themed games, but most of them are, you know, focused on one group of audiences. So for example, you know, Dead Rising is totally for zombie fans, and you know, Mighty No. 9 is for the 2D side scroll, you know, hardcore old style Japanese game lovers. And if I have to pick one genre, it's not really a genre, but if I have to pick somethingthat I really want to do is something that will appeal to kids, you know, students and adults or even the seniors at the same time. A game that will be loved by absolutely everyone. Something that Shigeru Miyamoto-san is doing so easily and doing so many times. Hopefully I can, you know, reach to that level and make a game similar to that. And hopefully I'm thinking right now is Recore.Can, you know, make that dream come true.
Can you tell me anything about Recore in terms of what it even is? Is it a shooter? Is it a third person shooter? Like, can you say anything about the game at all to give us a little bit of insight into what it is?
Recore についてもう現状で本当に何でもいいので、言えることがあればちょっと何でも教えてほしいです。
そうですね、あの Recore は大きなチャレンジをしている部分があって、割とそのシューターとかそういうただロボット、強いロボット作って戦って強くなるっていうことではなくて、そのなんていうのかな、コアにしこう込められたその気持ちっていうか、ロボットとちょっと逆の人間味みたいな部分であったりとか、そのこうやり取りの感情であったりとか、そういう部分を感じさせるようなゲームにしたいっていうことがあって、そのあたりで大きなチャレンジをしてて、それがうまくいけるっていう確信を持ちながらやってるんで、あのそのあたりを注目して見てくれるといいかなと思いますね。
So with Recore, we're not just trying to make a, you know, a third person shooter or a robot customization game or anything like that, but the general idea or the message we want to, you know, show or present with this title is sort of the human drama between robots and humans with this thing called Core. With this idea, I think we should be able to present this, you know, broad idea of, you know, human drama between the robots and humans. So it's kind of hard to say at this point without showing you anything or without showing any example, but we have a really big dream to realize with this game.
The turnaround seems pretty quick. Has the game been in development for a while now?
結構、まあ、今回のトレーラーであのすごい出来上がってる感があるんですけども、大体どんぐらいこう開発にもかけてるんでしょうか？
そうですね、あの今まで14ヶ月アマチュアと一緒にやってきたんで、結構あのもうプロとも終わって、あの言うと触れる状態っていうか、もう本当フルスケールの形で次の段階に入ってるんで、実際にはもっともっと見せれる部分あるんですけど、 まあ、いろんな戦略的な部分もあるんで、あのまだ E3 ではここまでしか見せてませんけど、あのかなり出来上がってはきてます。
So it's been 14 months since we first starting、working with Amateur Studios and we actually have a prototype you know, already done and the network into the next stage. I think we have a really solid gameplay we should be able to show, but you know, business strategy wise we think you know, for this E3 we'll only show the trailer and then we'll keep the actual gameplay or the demo to another, another opportunity. But in reality, we actually have something you know, really solid already built for the record.
What does it look like when, you know, you're obviously in Japan and there in the United States. What does it look like when you're producing or helping to create a game like this? Do you have to come over a lot? Or is there just a lot of emails exchanged and a lot of files and FTPing and all that kind of stuff? What does that kind of situation look like to kind of keep you sane since you obviously have so many games in development and you're obviously thousands and thousands of miles from the people that are actually making the game.
まあ、今回開発会社がアマチュアスチューディオで、アメリカにあるんですけども、実際コンセプトは稲根さんは多分日本にいたりするんですよ。その、この距離感での仕事ってどんな感じのものになってるんですか？このよく行ったり来たりするものなのか、それとも E メールでこう全部済ましてるのかって、どんな感じになってるんでしょうか？
あのどんどん昔よりやりやすくなって、今あのスカイプで簡単につながることができるんで、あの急なことがあってもそのスカイプでつながってやれるし、あの毎週、週に1回とか2回とかそういうこともできますし、当然あのフェイスティフェイスでやる大切さもあるんで、自分の方からあのアマチュアスタジオに行ってっていう、だからあのスタッフがあのテキサスにオースチンに飛んでオースチンで仕事するっていうこともやってますんで、定期的にそれは繰り返しながらスカイプを使って、常にコミュニケーションを取るようにしてます。
We pretty much use all the methods you mentioned right there、emails, Skype meeting. Actually, sometimes I actually fly over to Amateur Studio and talk to them face to face. But in a sense, compared to when we worked with them back in Capcom days, it's much easier now to work with the overseas developer because you know, the technology is there for us to useYou know, emails, Skypes, all that kind of stuff we can you know, use within the development process. So it's easier and that's definitely making things move faster.
Yeah, perfect. Nick, so I couldn't hear you and Kevin was talking in my earpiece so much that I thought I was going to actually strangle a man. So are we going to break now and coming back or are we kicking to... Are we kicking?
We're going to break unless you guys want to keep going.
Whatever you need.
Okay,
so that's it. So we'll wrap it up here with Inafune-san then. Okay. Mr. Inafune, I tell you this every time I meet you. You are my favorite game developer. You will always be my favorite game developer. Mega Man's the reason that I got into this industry and I started playing video games. As always, I want to thank you for your time. I wish you the very best of luck in your future endeavors. My very best to all the teams you're working with. I cannot wait.To play Mighty No. 9, so thank you so much for your time.
あの稲船さん会うと毎回言ってると思うんですけど、まあ、本当に稲船さん大ファンで一番もうリスペクトしているゲームクリエイターだと思いますし、実際自分がこの業界に入ってきたのもロックマンのきっかけなので、本当にもう稲船さんには頑張ってほしいと。でマイティに関してはもう本当に今ずっと応援してるし、これはもう絶対に応援しています、うん、なのであの本当に最後まであの頑張ってくださいということです。
ありがとう。 Thank you so much.
Oh, you're very welcome.